So before we get started looking into Augustine, I want to quickly talk about the final paper. Now, it may seem a little bit early to be discussing this to some of you, but this is a research paper, and I want to make sure that you know what the rules are, you know what the guidelines are early, so that you have plenty of time to think about this and to gather resources, right? Because I know that our own library is, they do what they can. They do what they can with the budget they're given. But they don't have all that much. You are likely going to, is somebody out there?
No. Yes.
Yes?
I think she might take
a
long
time. Okay, yeah, they do what they can with what they have, but they don't have all that much. First thing about this paper, right? You're gonna be choosing one text from any point in the semester, but it cannot be the same thing you wrote your midterm paper about, right? You have to choose something different. This is gonna be 2,400 to 3,000 words. So roughly 8 to 10 pages, right? So this is gonna be a substantial piece of work. You will need to consider a single work and examine the ways in which you think it develops a particular theme, paying close attention to the way it treats this common pattern, and constructing an argument as to why this pattern is important to understanding of the text you chose. So, you will need to use at least 5 outside sources. Yeah, Jenna. Oh,
Jesus Christ.
It's fine.
I'm very sorry.
All right, people, we start at 9:30. Be here at 9:30. When people show up late, it is disruptive. Where was I? Okay, right, so 5 outside sources. Now, these don't have to be works of criticism that are specifically on the text you're examining, right? You can look at, say, historical texts to provide context. You can look at works from other disciplines that, you know, might... Once again, 9:30. We begin at 9:30. It's after midterm, we shouldn't be doing this anymore. All right. Now where was I?
5 sources can be outside sources.
Okay, 5 sources, 5 outside sources. Yeah, they can come from any academic discipline, right? So say if you want to examine the leadership qualities of a particular character, right, you can look at stuff from, you know, you can look at stuff, say, from your business classes, right? If you want to examine, if you want to psychoanalyze a particular text, it's okay to look at stuff from psychology, right? As long as you're sort of keeping the context clear. Anything that you think would be relevant to your argument, right? As long as it's from some academic discipline, you can use.
Can we use more than 5 sources?
Pardon?
Can we use more than 5 sources?
I would prefer you not use more than 7. You must use at least 5. You should not use more than 7. And the reason is that I don't want you to get overwhelmed by your sources, right? I still want this to be your argument. This is coming from your head. You're using the sources to supplement your argument, right? You're using the sources to fine-tune and help advance your argument. Yeah, Sarah?
Are all of them outside sources?
What do you mean by...
Or is like one of them, like the book?
Okay, yeah, no, the text that you have to use, your primary source, doesn't count towards the 5. Right, it has to be 5 sources apart from the thing you're actually examining. Other questions before I proceed? Okay, so this is going to be due on Monday, December 5th. Right, you do get extra credit for going to the Writing Center, as with the first paper, and I am again willing to look at drafts up to 48 hours before the due date. Your works cited page also once again does not count towards the total word count. 2,400 words means 2,400 words. This is the minimum acceptable. And it has to be uploaded by midnight on the due date. So let's talk a little bit about what sorts of secondary sources are appropriate, what sorts of things you can be using for this, right? Appropriate sources for an assignment of this type are scholarly books and journals, and journal articles that you find online through our library databases. Right. What I don't want you doing is just doing like a Google search on Augustine's Confessions and using whatever comes up. Right. So don't use online random. Don't use random websites. Does anybody know how Google's search algorithm works? Okay. Basically, the way Google shows you results is based on the popularity of a site and how many times it's linked to by other sites. Right. So no human being is actually going and reviewing the information before they decide where to rank particular sites on your search list. So the reason I want you to look at scholarly books and journals is because these have to undergo what is called peer review. Does anybody know what peer review means in an academic context?
It has been reviewed by other professors and other, and it's been bound, this has some merit in it.
Yeah, basically it's been vetted by experts, right, who have determined that this is okay to publish, right? If I write an article and submit it to a journal, they're going to send it out to two or three other people in my field who are going to read it and go over it and decide whether or not this is worth publishing, right? Usually what happens is they send you something back that says, okay, yeah, we'll publish this, but with these changes, or so this is not appropriate for this journal, or so on and so forth, right? Things that get published in a scholarly journal have been through this process of review. It's been vetted by experts who have determined that, yes, this is, even if we don't 100% agree with this, it is responsible, like, from a scholarly standpoint. So, apart from not using random websites that you find on Google searches, don't use Wikipedia or any other encyclopedia. Does anybody know why I don't want you using Wikipedia? Do you understand? Yeah, secret.
You can edit, just go in and type anything. It's not accurate.
You used to be able to, right? They've actually made it harder to do that. I remember a couple years ago, Stephen Colbert had his viewers single-handedly save the African elephant from near extinction by going to the Wikipedia article and changing the number in the wild, right? To demonstrate how easy it was to manipulate information on Wikipedia. You can't actually do that anymore, but here's the thing about Wikipedia, right? It's by and large no better or worse than any other encyclopedia. And an encyclopedia is just a sort of first go-to source for general information about a topic. Right? You're not really going to get any kind of in-depth scholarly examination of anything from an encyclopedia article.
What about using the sources at the bottom they have?
If the sources look good, if they look valid, then yeah, you can use the bibliographies you find on in an encyclopedia article or on a Wikipedia article, right?
That could at least give you a place to start.
Yeah. And just to remind everybody too, I have given you a place to start, right? Remember that there's a bibliography in each folder on GeorgiaView. So I don't want to hear from anybody, Dr. Moyer, I can't find any sources, right? Bullshit. I've given you sources. I know that all of these are available, if not in our library, at least through the consortium, right? So with a little bit of planning, you should be able to get all of those. Don't use book reviews. Book reviews are purely evaluative, right? Their only purpose is to tell you whether or not to read or not read a particular book. And don't use newspaper or magazine articles, like just from regular popular newspapers or popular magazines. These are not written for a scholarly audience. The average American newspaper is written at a sixth grade level, right? We are all reading and writing, I think, above a sixth grade level, right? So this is the stuff we're going to stick to. Yeah, secret.
TED Talks.
TED Talks are also intended for a popular audience. not for a scholarly audience. And I really do want you to learn how to work with scholarly materials. So I'd say, yeah, TED Talks are out. Also, it might be hard to find one that's relevant to ancient literature. Okay, so I do wanted to show you a couple of things on the library website as well to help you with your research.
Is that on Georgia B? The guidelines? Paper 2?
They will be tonight. Once I get home, I will post them. Okay, so library website. Most of what we're going to be doing your searching will be in Galileo. And please do not just use the Galileo search bar here, because that searches every database that our library subscribes to. And you'll turn up a lot of irrelevant results. What you want to do instead is browse by subject. Go to literature, language, and literary criticism. Literature, literary criticism. And this gives you a list of databases that you can check out. Probably the most useful for you will be JSTOR. Which will link directly to journal articles. All right, have any of you used JSTOR before? Okay, a couple of you. I know, yeah, any of you who took Comp 2 with me, I know at least one or two of you did, have used JSTOR. So you want to click on Advanced Search, and you have a couple of bars here, right? These help you do a basic Boolean search. So say you want to write your paper on today's text, right? So you go with Augustine and Confessions and Women, right? In general, the more specific you can be about what you're looking for, the more relevant your results are going to be, right? Just like doing a search with a regular search engine. You can limit to articles and books. You can filter by disciplines. So because this is an ancient Roman text, we want to look maybe at classical studies. So this will only give us results from classical studies journals. And then we click search. And this gives us 31 results that we can then look through. You can download the PDF directly, right? Save it onto your desktop, and it's yours in perpetuity, right? You don't have to keep going back and forth to find it. Okay, so that's JSTOR. It might also be worth for you checking out, if you're doing something relatively more recent, the Modern Language Association bibliography. The MLA bibliography isn't going to be much help to you if you're working on an ancient text. Right? If you're working on something like Gilgamesh, something that's written in an ancient language, MLA isn't going to do much for you. For that, use JSTOR, or you could also use Lion. That'll turn up some stuff for you. But if you're working on something that is written in a modern language, MLA is actually often the best place to go. So say we want to do a search on Song of Roland and War. This gives us 5 results. Now sometimes this will give you a direct link to an article. Other times it won't. So what do you do if it doesn't give you a direct link to the article? Does that mean you can't get it? Not necessarily. Actually, just about any article that you find on these bibliographies, you can get through interlibrary loan. Have any of you used interlibrary loan before? Okay, you have. Good. So for the rest of you, let me just quickly show you how it works. It's really easy, and it will upload articles. Essentially, the other libraries will scan and upload journal articles for you to a page that you can log in and go to.
So, is it only available for a limited time?
Yeah, it only stays on the page for a limited time, but you can download it and save it to your desktop, and then it's yours.
Okay.
So just click on the drop-down link. Right. If you don't have a login, click on first-time users. And it'll run you through how to set up a username and password. But since I'm not a first-time user, we'll go back, I'll log in, and I'll just show you briefly how to request various things. So you can request articles, you can request books that our library doesn't have, the consortium doesn't have. You can also request books if you're on the outs with our library and they won't let you take things out. You can also request, if you don't need a whole book, if you know you just need a single chapter of a book, you can just request that chapter. Which means having to load a whole book around. Right, but yeah, essentially, right, so say I want one of these journal articles, right? Okay, let's go with The Song of Roland, How the Middle Ages Aren't Old. That is in Cambridge Journal of Postcolonial Literary Inquiry. Submit request, and this will send this request out to any other libraries that subscribe to Iliad, and if one of them has this journal and this article, I'll get an email saying, hey, we uploaded this for you. You go to your Iliad page, and I don't have any articles waiting for me right now. But I would go to electronically received articles to get any. It'll have a little icon you can click on to get a PDF, basically. Okay, so any questions about the paper, about how to use the library databases, about how to use Iliad, anything? Yeah, Reagan. I thought I checked the syllabus this morning and it said the
unless you change
fifth.
It, if you change when I printed it out at the beginning, it says the
okay, I may have changed it since then. The final exam is on the 2nd. The final paper is due on the 5th. Oh yeah, right. Because when I first emailed all of you the syllabus before the semester started, they hadn't set the exam dates and times yet. So yeah, once they had, I probably changed the due date of the paper, so the paper wasn't due on the same day as the exam.
Okay.
So yeah, so you have 3 more days to do the paper than you thought you did, right? So good.
And so the exam, that's going to be our group project.
That's going to be the group presentation, and we're going to talk about that next time. What I'm going to do is give you a selection of texts explain a little bit about them to you, and let you all vote as to which ones you want to work on. I try to give everybody their first or second choice. Usually I've been able to give everybody their first or second choice. And then you'll be grouped up, and we'll discuss the actual assignment itself the following period. Okay, so any questions about the library, about the paper, about research, about anything? Yes, Megan.
So it's due at 11:59 on Monday, right?
Yep, 11:59 p.m. precisely. Anything else? Okay, great. And let's talk about Augustine. Yes, secret.
Always about Augustine.
Okay, good. Go for it. Yeah, shoot.
I noticed throughout this text, mentions what we call the seven deadly sins.
Okay.
In a way. And I'm just wondering if that was like a pattern or on purpose.
Well, in Augustine's time, the seven deadly sin, the idea of the seven deadly sins wouldn't really have been a thing. Does there seem to be one sin that he's a little bit more fixated on than others?
Yes, lust and pride.
Yeah, he seems to bring everything back to lust and pride, right? To physical desires, physical fleshly desires. So yeah, the seven deadly sins wouldn't have been really a concept that he would have been familiar with. But yeah, you're good to know that he is framing things in terms of what we would today think of as sin. Other observations, other questions before we just launch into this? Anything that particularly confused you or that really struck you? Yeah, go ahead. Okay, Virgil's Aeneid, yeah. We didn't actually read this, but we did talk about it a little bit. What did I do with my marker? Yeah, so the Aeneid is the great epic of early imperial Rome. Right, this is the epic that Augustus, the first emperor, sponsored the composition of. Now, we might remember some discussion of this when we talked about Ovid. What were the values that Augustus was keen to promote in Rome? Yeah, okay, yeah, right. The idea of the nuclear family, right? Good. What else?
No lesbian
Okay, yeah.
Women.
Right, rigid sexual morality. Not just for women, according to Augustus, but for everybody. Right? He wanted everybody to just keep it in their pants, damn it. What else? What about the status of Rome itself? What did Augustus believe or want people to believe about Rome?
That it was eternal, but it was.
Yes. Good. That Rome had always been, in some form. Aeneas, after all, is a Trojan prince, so he's just carrying on when he gets to Italy to found Rome, right? An earlier tradition. And Rome, as long as its people remain faithful and remain moral, remain dutiful to their families, to the emperor, and to the state religion, Rome will never fall. Rome will always be. So Augustus's vision is a vision of stability. And Aeneas, the hero of this epic, is himself a symbol of duty and stability. Does anybody remember when we talked about Ovid? We touched on this. How is Aeneas usually represented in art?
Is he the one that was holding the little kid and carrying the old man?
Exactly, yeah. He's carrying his old lame father on his shoulders and leading his little son by the hand, right? A support for the older generation and a guide for the younger generation. That's the Roman idea, the Roman masculine ideal. The ideal of pietas, or civic duty. So, this actually provides an interesting contrast to the times in which Augustine lived. Augustine lives from sort of the end of the 4th century to the beginning of the 5th, in a period that is sometimes called Late Antiquity. Or also sometimes simply the later Roman Empire. In fact, he's living in the last years of Rome as a unified empire. So we talk about late antiquity. Usually the period we're talking about is roughly 3rd century CE. To the 5th century. And the 3rd century had been marked by several developments. On the one hand, the decline of the Roman state religion. Does anybody remember what the Roman state religion looked like?
They kind of adopted the Greek religious format.
Yeah, the official religion of the empire essentially took the Greek Olympian gods and kind of worked the emperor into them, right? So the state cult was this older Greek polytheism mixed with worship of the emperor. This was the official Roman state religion. But as Rome expands, right, their policy towards the cultures they conquer is not to eradicate the native religious traditions of those places, but to try to incorporate them into the imperial cults. So they bring back these other gods from other places, right? You remember at the beginning of the course when we talked about that cult of wacky priests with the tambourines and the yelling and the magic mushrooms and the self-castration?
Yes.
Yeah, this is one of those foreign cults that was brought into Rome. The cult of the Egyptian goddess Isis became very popular in Rome. Other foreign mystery religions. And many of these could not be assimilated into the state religion for various reasons. Does anybody, for example, know why the official Roman government's policy towards Christianity was one of alternating toleration and persecution? Why the persecution?
They couldn't assimilate it. It was only one god.
Mm-hmm. And that god's not the emperor, right? So it was regarded as a threat to the state and a threat to the security of the state because it could not be assimilated into the imperial cult. Right? Other polytheistic religions like, okay, sure, you know, we'll build a shrine to Baal, we'll build a shrine to, to Cernunnos or, whatever other god
your people worship. But yeah, Christianity could not be incorporated into the imperial cult.
Because instead of the emperor being the center, the quote-unquote God is the center.
Well, yeah, the Judeo-Christian God is the center. Yeah, exactly. Yes, I guess, yeah, Yahweh is the center. This was also one of the part of the problem they had with the Jews. So they couldn't assimilate the Jews into the imperial cult either. So there's this huge patchwork of religious traditions in the empire in conflict. Right, on the one hand, you have the state religion. You also have, particularly among Greek aristocrats, a philosophical position called Neoplatonism. Do any of you know anything about Plato or about Plato's philosophy? What did Plato believe about the world? According to Plato, what is the world that we see and the world that we interact with on a daily basis?
Knowledge.
That's part of it, yeah.
Does this go back to the metaphor of light being chained to the cave, staring at the shadows?
That's Plato, yeah.
Right. Something back to the argument of the rationalist versus the empiricist.
No, that would be, the rationalist and empiricist thing would be much more modern.
Okay. The world we see is just shadows. It's not true. It's an illusion.
Exactly. The world that we see, the world that we experience every day, is a shadow, an imitation of a higher reality that, by and large, we can't access. So yeah, the material world is a shadow or an imitation of a higher spiritual world. In addition to this Neoplatonic philosophy, this resurrection of Platonic philosophy from ancient Greece, right, you had Christianity entering the mix, but it wouldn't be a Christianity really that we would recognize. And modern Christians probably wouldn't find much that they recognize in these practices of the ancient world either. For one thing, through much of late antiquity, Christianity was still kind of, it was basically a Jewish splinter sect and was regarded as such. And there are various sects that go off in other directions, right? There's a Jerusalem church, for example, that remains very Jewish in character. The Greek and Roman churches incorporate influences from Greek philosophy. And there are other strands that eventually get branded what are called heresies, right? Turnings away. For example, there's an offshoot of Christianity called Arianism, A-R-I-A-N-I-S-M, named after a priest named called Arius. And Arianism preached that there was, in fact, only one God. He denied the idea of the Trinity, right? That God, that the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit are one being. He said, no, God is a separate, transcendent being, and the Son, Jesus, is just an emanation of him that intercedes on behalf of human beings. And Arius's departure from orthodoxy was only one of many, right? There were many different Christian sects that believed different things running around the Roman Empire. There was the beginnings of a unified church and unified belief, but it was still very, very much split apart. You also had a religion popular among Roman soldiers that we still know very little about because they didn't leave behind any scriptures, and all they left behind were a bunch of kind of cryptic statues called Mithraism. And they left behind these kind of vaulted temples with paintings of the night sky and stars all over the ceilings.
Something that's tested with astronomy.
They think maybe, yeah, it has something to do with a certain combination of constellations. And there's a statue at the center of all Mithraic temples of the central god, Mithras, stabbing a bull in the throat. So there's some kind of ritual bull sacrifice significance
Mithras
there.
Mithras has an M-I-T-H-R-O-S.
A-S. Mithras. One thing that we do know about it is that the birthday of Mithras was December 25th. So we see a lot of these ancient world religions merging some of their traditions together, right? The Bible doesn't say anything about when Jesus was born. And in fact, Christmas, historically, really until about the 19th century, wasn't an important holiday, right? It didn't really matter all that much when Jesus the physical man was born. What mattered was Easter, what mattered was the resurrection. So in order to give him a birthday, to co-opt someone else's festival, the early church makes the birthday of Jesus December 25th, sort of decided by fiat. Now, what's most relevant to our discussion of Augustine there's another sect that combines a lot of, or really a group of sects that combine a lot of these ideas together called the Gnostics. G-N-O-S-T-I-C-S. Their name, or the name we give them, this isn't what they call themselves, comes from the Greek word gnosis, or knowledge. And most Gnostic traditions shared a similar set of beliefs. One, that the material world was evil. Everything in the material world is evil and corrupt. And it is merely a reflection of, a dark, corrupt reflection of, a higher spiritual reality. And the God of the material world, the God who created the material world, is himself a corrupt and evil shadow of the God who created that higher spiritual reality. They regarded Jesus as an intermediary between this corrupt reality and that higher reality that is ruled over by a genuinely good and kind and loving God, right? So do we see how some of these influences are coming to play in this Gnostic idea of the world?
They believe that Jesus was the opposite of the higher reality, that he was a shadow? Is that what you're saying?
No, not that Jesus is a shadow, but that he intercedes with us who are stuck in the material world on behalf of the God of that higher reality, right? And for a Gnostic, the way to achieve gnosis, the way to achieve knowledge of that higher reality, is generally through self-denial, right? Through denial of the physical passions, right? So many of them were strict vegetarians and only ate as much as they needed to. Many of them practiced complete abstinence from sex, which is ironic because many of the early Christian fathers who were writing against the Gnostics and their beliefs accused them of all kinds of deviant sexual practices.
Is Gnosis is that where we get the root word for agnostic? You know how they talk about current modern agnostic?
It's the same root. What agnostic means in Greek is we cannot know. So a modern agnostic is someone who refuses to take a position on whether there is or is not a God, right? Because we can't be certain. So yeah, it does come from the same Greek root word. So Augustine, as a young man, belonged to a Gnostic sect called the Manichaeans. That had been founded in Persia in the 2nd century, and that believed all of the above, right? All the things I just explained to you about Gnosticism, plus that Jesus lived on the moon. Right? Which, you know, I mean, again, yeah, okay, yeah, it sounds weird and a little bit loony to us, right? But from their particular vantage point, made sense. Yeah, well, they believed that the moon was a sort of halfway point between this corrupt material sphere and the higher reality that they were trying to access, right? So it made sense to them that Jesus would live in that sort of in-between point.
I didn't find it amusing that they actually believed that so much as the way you just suddenly... Like,
yeah.
Some kind of confession or something.
Yeah, no, that's, yeah, that is what they believed, you know, that Jesus lived on the moon. Do we see influences, do you think, in Augustine of this kind of thinking, even as he has converted to Christianity? Do we still see traces of this kind of belief system? What sins does he seem to worry about the most? Or what does he seem to relate all sin to? Fleshly lust, right? Even things that aren't specifically sexual, he tends to talk about in terms of fleshly lusts. Right? The sorts of things that the Manichaeans in particular tried very, very hard to resist. Now, do any of you know anything about Augustine's theological beliefs? What the important contribution he makes to theology is? Not in the Confessions, but in his other writings. Okay, Augustine is one of the first major Christian thinkers to argue for the doctrine of predestination. What does this mean?
No matter what you do in life, you're destined to either go to heaven or hell.
Yeah. Before you were even born,
your fate was already sealed.
Yep, God had already decided whether you were saved or damned. Right. Those who are saved, who are going to be saved, are referred to as the elect. Everyone else is damned.
This is like when those early Americans learned it.
Well, this is a belief that has a very long shelf life, right? Yeah, that Augustine is writing at the beginning of the 5th century, but these are things that people still believe at least into the 17th and 18th centuries.
There are some that still believe that today.
There are, I mean, I'll be honest, you know, like, as you may or may not have figured out, I'm not a particularly religious person myself, so I'm not entirely up on current trends in belief. I do know, historically, that this is a belief system that lasted a very, very long time.
Puritans, that's who I was trying to remember.
Yeah.
Puritans, specifically, when we learned about it, had been, they, when you said the elect, I mm-hmm. remember what they were talking about in predestination. That was the name of the people I was trying to remember.
Yeah, basically any Protestant sect that comes out of the Calvinist tradition believes this. And Calvin is going back to St. Augustine to make this argument. But what this ultimately reflects is also Augustine's early Manichaean beliefs, right? That there is a clear divide. The universe is split up between the forces of good and the forces of evil. And only those who were born without the stain of corruption on their souls, only those who were born without that earthly taint on them, are the ones who will be saved, who will go to heaven, who will get to access that higher reality. So while Augustine is himself a Christian and one of the people who helps to shape early Christian belief, he's getting a lot of his ideas from non-scriptural sources, right? Just these things that are floating around the Roman Empire. Because when you think about it, like, what did the empire provide to people who lived within it?
Security and the ability to travel.
Yeah, security and the ability to travel. That was the big thing, the ability to travel, right? Not only did the Romans build roads all over Europe and the Middle East, right? And North Africa. They also patrolled those roads, kept them safe. What this meant is that, a scholar from Judea could wander all the way to what is now Spain on foot and not have to worry too much about being attacked by bandits. Right? So ideas from every corner of the empire could make it not just to Rome, but to other far-flung reaches of the empire. So the fact that Augustine grows up in North Africa doesn't mean that he is only exposed to North African ideas, right? To the ideas of his particular native place. He is part of a larger network that circulates all of these systems of belief and all of these ideas. In fact, the form that the confessions take, what did you notice about the form of this? Who does he seem to be addressing through most of this? Who's he talking to?
God.
Yeah, it takes the form of this kind of letter to God, right? This was not a common early Christian form. We have those epistles in the New Testament, right? The letters of Paul. But are Paul's letters written to God?
No, aren't they written to the tribes?
Yeah, they're written to different nations, right? Different nations of people he intends to address, or to different individuals. So Paul is still writing to people. Now, this Greek philosophical tradition, these Neoplatonists, who believed in a kind of unknown God who lived in a higher reality we couldn't access, would often write confessional letters to that unknown God, trying to explain themselves to him. So the form that Augustine adopts here is not a Christian form, it's a Neoplatonic one. And some of this is dictated, again, by the fact that Christianity as a coherent, solidified, single belief system is still, in Augustine's time, a very, very new thing. Right? 25 years before Augustine was born, there was a council at a place called Nicaea, called by the Emperor Constantine, to try to organize and codify Christian doctrine, right? To determine what Christianity ultimately was going to look like. Basically, which of these competing Christian sects, or which elements of which competing Christian sects, would be formed into the Orthodox version of the religion. So there are a couple of things they did here, right? One, they affirmed most modern Christian doctrines. The Arians, for example, were invited. Their representatives came, but they lost the battle over the doctrine of the Trinity. Right, so that remains. That becomes Orthodox Christian belief. The other thing that they did here was choose the books of the biblical canon. Right, there was no Bible, or no New Testament anyway, no Christian Bible, prior to 325 CE. There were a number of different scriptures that circulated among early Christians, including those texts that become the New Testament, right? So the Gospels of Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, the letters of Paul, the Acts of the Apostles, which is originally just part of the book of Luke, actually, the Gospel of Luke, actually. It was the final chapters of the Gospel of Luke were the Acts of the Apostles. And the Revelation of St. John, right? So these books are all circulating among early Christians with a number of other books that aren't chosen to become part of the biblical canon. Right, have any of you heard anything about like lost gospels or, you know, these books that didn't make it into the Bible? I think they're sometimes called Apocrypha.
Yes.
Yeah, that's where this comes from. Those are the books that didn't make the cut in 325. They were regarded as either less authentic or the ideas they preached maybe too close to some of these other belief systems. Right? In particular, there's a sayings gospel called the Gospel of Thomas that was regarded as being too close to Gnostic beliefs. But as you can see with Augustine, right, these ideas still make it into the final mix. Right, so this is all part of a massive intellectual ferment. And this is all fueled as well by great social instability. Right, one thing that the third century in particular is marked by: rapid turnover of Roman emperors. Right, several emperors in this particular century only rule for a matter of months, and most of them are military dictators. Right, basically they're guys who, they command a particular legion, the legion raises them up as emperor, and then when the emperor doesn't do what the legion wants, the legion kills him. Happened a whole bunch of times. Now, by the 4th century, when Augustine is born, things are a little bit more stable, right? The two emperors who rule for most of the early 4th century, when Rome is still restabilizing itself, are Diocletian and Constantine. Diocletian rules from 284 to 306. And Constantine from 306 to 337. So both have pretty long reigns and pretty stable reigns, right? What Diocletian attempts to do is both stabilize the Roman line of succession so that we don't have an emperor a month anymore. And he blames the decline and stability of the Roman state on the decline of the state religion. So he becomes an enthusiastic persecutor, not just of Christians, but of anybody who doesn't follow the state religion line. Now, what is Constantine famous for?
Known for, like, putting out Christianity?
Yeah, Constantine is the emperor who makes Christianity, in fact, the state religion. Right? So instead of trying to continue to enforce the old imperial religion, right, Constantine sees this as a losing battle. He makes this newer religion the official religion of the Roman state, but remains tolerant of other religious traditions, right? It becomes the state religion. Christians are granted some advantages within the state, but other traditions are continue to be allowed to practice. And some of this is attributed to a battlefield vision that Constantine saw. But I think, you know, Constantine was a smart guy. And I think that some of his calculations were in fact cynical and political, right? He's dealing with a tradition that is much newer, and that he also has, as we see with the Council of Nicaea, a chance to shape, a chance to have a say in what happens and how it's going to work. Yeah. And yeah, this is essentially the background to what's going on in Augustine's text. Now, one of the things we have in Augustine as well is one of the very first examples of an autobiography. It was not normal at this time for people to write their own life stories. In fact, even most of Augustine's influences were a bunch of popular texts about saints. There was this tradition of saintly biographies. And we are running out of ink, aren't we? But what tends to happen at the end of the biographies of early saints? How do they get to be saints? What's that? Yeah, do they die of natural causes, safe and warm in their beds? No, yep. Yes. Most of these end in martyrdom. And martyrdom was the result of official state suppression, right? They're martyred because the state doesn't want them practicing this subversive religion. They're martyred because they're breaking the law. Well, what happens when suddenly your subversive cult becomes the state religion? What happens to opportunities for martyrdom? Yeah, unless you are willing to wander very, very far from home and do, you know, missionary work in other places, right? Then you may still very well be martyred. But if you are remaining within the network of the empire, yeah, your opportunities for martyrdom are greatly reduced. So you're no longer focused on external enemies, on external threats, right? The threat is no longer that Roman soldiers are going to beat down your door, drag you out of your house, and throw you to the lions in the Colosseum. That's not going to happen. What does happen is that these enemies, the threats that you face, become internal rather than external. So you're no longer worried about Roman soldiers. You're worried about your own base impulses. You're worried about your own sinful needs and your own sinful desires. And this is a big part of why Augustine keeps talking about these evil impulses that he feels, right? He's not afraid of being arrested. Essentially, he regards himself as his own worst enemy. And apart from the fleshly lusts he describes, where does he seem to locate most of his sinful impulses? Yeah, go ahead, Ty. Yes, yes, some of it is just a sort of native impulse towards rebellion, right? When he talks about the pear tree, right, he talks about the pleasure of doing evil for the sake of doing evil, right? That it's fun to do something wrong. It feels good to get away with something. Does he go after the pears on the pear tree alone?
No.
No, he's with a group of friends, right? What about in his student days? Yeah.
The Overturners.
Yep. He associates with a group in Carthage called the Overturners. And even in his fleshly lusts, is this a problem that he works out alone? Now, there's this mistress who's been with him for many years, whom he sends back to Africa when he's about to get married, right? So, where are most of his sinful impulses apparently located? Yeah, in his relationships with other people. Good. Now, what he's participating in here is another early Christian tradition, right? One of these early sects of Christianity rises up in Egypt, and it's a monastic sect. It's led by a guy who comes to be known as Anthony the Abbot. Anthony the Abbot. And Anthony and his followers go out into the desert and largely reject contact with other people. Right? It's a kind of extreme ascetic renunciate tradition. Right? They go out and they live in cells in the desert. They live very simple lives, and they largely stay away from other people. Because these other human relationships, in part because they do give so much satisfaction, they're so difficult to give up, are regarded as spiritually polluting. Now, what seems to be Augustine's most important interpersonal relationship here? Yeah, what's going on with his relationship with his mother, do you think? Why so much focus here on his mother?
Is he her only child?
No, he had brothers.
She was partially responsible for his conversion to Christianity.
Yeah, okay, the mother on the one hand has been begging him to convert all his life. What's his mother like? What do we notice about his mother, particularly in the chapter in which she dies? How, for example, did she behave towards his father when they were married? Why didn't Augustine's hot-tempered father beat her like other Roman men beat their wives?
Because she just served him. She did what he said.
Yeah, she provides this example of extreme submission, right? She does everything he says, right?
Mm-hmm.
So the mother has been begging him to convert. She has this incredibly sort of submissive, like this sort of denial of self, right? And do we see any sort of more material expressions in her death of this kind of denial of self? If you look on page 854, such thoughts I uttered, though not in that order in those actual words, but you know, O Lord, that on that day when we talked of these things, the world with all its delights seemed cheap to us in comparison with what we talked of. And my mother said, Son, for my own part, I no longer find joy in anything of this world. What I am still to do here and why I am here, I know not, now that I no longer hope for anything from this world. One thing there was, for which I desired to remain still a little longer in this life, that I should see you, a Catholic Christian, before I died. This God has granted me in superabundance, in that now I see you, his servant, to the contempt of all worldly happiness. What then am I doing here? So her self-denial also expresses itself in a kind of world denial, right? That the things of this world are nothing compared to the things of the next world, of the spiritual world.
So does he see her as a sort of saint, something to achieve to or something to become?
Yeah, he certainly seems to admire her fortitude, right? And admire her spirit of submission. And when she does die and is to be buried, right, my brother said something to the effect that he would be happier if she were to die in her own land and not in a strange country. But as she heard this, she looked at him anxiously, restraining him with her eye, because he savored of earthly things. And then she looked at me and said, see the way he talks. And then she said to us both, lay this body wherever it may be. Let no care of it disturb you. This looks really different to us, given the perspective of the ancient Mediterranean world we've had thus far, right? Why is burial so important to the Greeks, to the Romans, to the Babylonians?
If you're not properly buried, you can't move on.
Yeah, if you're not properly buried, you can't move on to the next world. And the next world, by and large, sucks, right? It's lame. You're a bodiless spirit who floats around with nothing to do. There's nothing really to hope for. So your earthly glory will be reflected in the monument that your survivors build for you, right? And people will remember you and you'll live on in that way. How is Augustine's mother's response a departure from that?
Body is a shell or something that cannot be followed. Mm-hmm. Her soul is something entirely separate from the body itself. The body doesn't mean anything because it will return to the dust from which it came.
Yeah, this is a total reversal of the ancient world afterlife narrative, right? Where this world matters, the next world doesn't. In this case, this world doesn't matter. It's the next world that matters, right? The world of matter, the world of human beings and human relationships, is not important. It's that higher spiritual realm that is important. And, you know, early Christianity, as we noted, is just one of many different systems preaching more or less that same thing in this period. Basically, this is the system that wins, in part through imperial support. But yeah, the important thing to get out of this is that reversal of the ancient world narrative, right? We're moving into a different way of looking at life and death that is going to be reflected, particularly in the medieval texts that we're going to be looking at over the next few weeks. So we are out of time. I have some reading questions for you for next time. I want to remind you, as you are reading the selections from the Quran, right, you're only reading those first two parts, right? You're just reading the opening and the part labeled the feast. You don't have to read the whole excerpts.